Superannuation. Let's bring in our guest this morning. We're joined by the new Deputy Prime Minister and Leader of the National Party, Barnaby Joyce. Thanks for your company and congratulations.
Oh, well, thank you very much, Peter. It's an awesome responsibility, and just keep my head screwed on and my feet on the ground and work very hard, and I'm sure it'll all work out.
Well, let's start today, if I can, by asking you about this speculation around superannuation that's in the News Limited papers today, that low-income earners might be able to access their superannuation, giving them a potential pay rise of somewhere around $60 or $90, a significant one each pay packet period. You're now on the Expenditure Review Committee, obviously, as the Nationals leader and Deputy PM. Is this something that you're considering?
Well, I won't make my first comment on the Expenditure Review Committee to start publicly airing their deliberations, but what I can say is that within a whole scope of things, we will make sure that we have a proper tax policy to take to the Australian people. I don't think there's a great prize to have a policy out in front of the other. I think really what matters is that it's well thought out, that you have the capacity at the end of the day to clearly have a policy that stands up to scrutiny. And you know, we're not having the election next week. We've got a little bit of time up our sleeve here. And I think the most pertinent thing is to have a proper oversight on all the things that the possible combinations and permutations. What we've had in the past is a discussion about one section of one policy, the GST, and we don't want to go down that path again. We want to make sure that the whole ERC process is one that comes to a conclusion so that we can go to the Australian people with a compendium of tax policy for their assessment. And the fact that the Labor Party have got a policy out early is really neither here nor there by the time the election comes.
Those comments, Minister, sound very statesmanlike, but can I just ask you in particular about Labor's negative gearing policy? What's your view about the consequences of Labor's policy?
Well, I think that what the Labor Party has to understand is that there are always two sides to every coin. Yeah, sure, you can talk about, well, this will make houses more affordable. But let's remember that you're also therefore saying, you have to be saying, this will make houses that'll call into question the value. And this is a value that so many people in the western suburbs have gone out and borrowed money against. If you inherently are going to make the value of their asset cheaper, you're inherently going to make them at a greater risk to the bank from whom they borrowed the money. I mean, the banks are going to be very interested if all of a sudden they wake up and the house they've lent $1 million over is now only worth $800,000 or $700,000. They'll obviously say, well, in that case, you need to make a substantial equity injection into this asset to keep us on the right side of our prudential regulator. That's a discussion. If what they say is correct, that houses are now going to be more affordable, then naturally enough, people who own those houses are going to have to be losing equity in them.
Well, that's a pretty strong statement. It sounds as though you, as Deputy Prime Minister, intend to wage a scare campaign against this policy.
Well, no, I just think that you can't go out, Paul, and make one statement, oh, well, you know, we, the Labor Party, are going to make houses in the western suburbs cheaper, without obviously acknowledging that if you make houses cheaper, that the people who own houses are going to be losing value in their houses. Now, there's a whole range of people who are very interested in keeping the value of their houses. So it just needs proper deliberation and not the sort of fuel watch, grocery watch, 2020 idea analysis. We need to do this in a methodical process so that if you are going to go into that section of policy adjustment, you do it in a way that doesn't undermine the inherent major investment, major nest egg that so many people in the western suburbs and throughout Australia have, and that is the value of their house. And now, how do you affect the value of the house? Well, you affect the number of people who could buy it. And if you take away a large section of people who have an interest in buying your house, then of course it's supply and demand. Take away the demand and the price has to go down.
In terms of the tax debate in the election year, how important is it for the government to be offering substantial cuts in personal income tax?
Obviously, it's in the interest of all governments that as wages increase through the course of time, and if you have tax rates that are static, then more and more people move into a higher tax bracket. Obviously, this is a revenue stream for a government, but it means that people start to question why they're working so hard. We have a position where people, you, me, all your listeners, if they have a job, they'll go to work on Monday for the government and a lot of Tuesday for the government. And they have no real interest in going to work all of Monday, all of Tuesday, and if this continued on, you know, some of Wednesday. So the only way you can deal with that is progressively to increase the tax brackets in line with the increase in wages. Now, to some people ask for it just to be locked in, to be indexed. That would be a massive cost that that you'd have to find by cutting services. So you always are playing catch up and trying to make sure by the increase in the tax-free threshold, which we've done in the past, by an increase in the tax rates, that we try and somehow keep in line with the increase in wages. Once upon a time, a person getting, for instance, $100,000 a year was thought of to be a top wage earner. Now, many families would say that that amount of money is not that remarkable.
Mr. Joyce, can I ask you about the budget deficit? Do you see tax reform as a way to deal with the growing budget deficit, or should the budget deficit be primarily addressed by cutting spending?
Well, I think that in any business, and the government is the same, our nation is the same, there is not just a one solution. If you want to talk about revenue streams, well, we'll talk about tax. But you've also got to talk about your capacity to be prudent with your expenditure, make sure you're reducing your expenditure, because that fundamentally drives your requirements for a tax base. So we have to look at both, and you also have to have a serious discussion. If people don't want to, if they're scared about the revenue side, they don't particularly want to talk about the expenses side because that's attached to services, then they fall back to this discussion, oh, well, let's increase the size of the pie, let's increase the business. Then you've got to have a very calculated decision about what you actually mean by this decision, how you actually grow the business. And for our part in agriculture, we talk about dams, we talk about water infrastructure, we talk about the things that take an acre of land from $200-$300 an acre to up to $5,000-$10,000 an acre. These are the things that actually drive an increase in the size of your business, and you have to have more resilience as a nation so that when people say, oh, well, we don't want the live cattle trade, you say, well, that is a decision that actually reduces the size of the business. So you should be trying to expand your live cattle trade. You should be trying to expand your capacity to get those soft commodities into new markets. They're the decisions of a prudent government that tries to grow the size of the business. And I think everybody would have to say that in that space, we as a government have been exceptionally good with 70 live animal destinations, 3 free trade agreements. We have rural commodities now that are our second biggest exports after iron ore. We are actually driving that section of the business forward, but we have to have the resilience of the Australian people, because all the time we'll run up against people from the Greens who want to shut things down, from certain groups who want to shut things down.
But you
can't do that.
You've often sounded the alarm bell on the growing debt burden in terms of the budget and also in terms of government debt. What kind of timetable would you like to see for the budget to return to surplus? And should this be a priority for the first budget of the Turnbull government?
Well, I can assure you that if we return the budget to surplus in the first budget, there would be an absolute overwhelming pull pushback by the general community, because it would require massive structural changes. This is something that we need to be on a path towards doing, but we need to do it diligently. We need to do it in such a way as the Australian people go with us. All we can continue to say to the Australian people is we are fixing a problem that we did not create. The Labor Party created this. When we left, when Howard and Costello left, there was money in the bank. The world owed us money. We didn't owe the world money. We were in surpluses. And then it just went completely A over T.
But Barnaby Joyce, can I jump in there?
And now we've got it. And if you want to continue on that way, just put the other crowd back in again.
But notwithstanding that it is true that the Labor government inherited no net debt, and then you've inherited a significant amount of net debt, net debt has effectively doubled during the last 2.5 years. The size of the budget deficit is not dissimilar to what it was during the period of massive deficits being handed down by Wayne Swan. I will remember us doing interview after interview where you were complaining about just how much of an emergency this was becoming, and you were frustrated that people weren't listening to you, quite frankly, at the time. Here we are 2.5 years on, and debt continues to balloon, and the projections of deficits is huge. Are you disappointed at how long long and how slow the road back to surplus seems to have become?
Well, we have to make sure that the Australian people go along with us for that, what I could say, a budget challenge. And if you take one of those decisions in isolation, something that's lauded, when the Labor Party came forward, the Labor, the Greens and the Independents came forward with the NBN, a great idea, but it was just there was just a complete lack of planning around how they did it. And we're looking at a total cost when we arrived here of about $100 billion. And this is just obscene. You can't do that to people. You can't put that sort of expense on your credit card as a nation and think there's no ramifications for it. And that's just one. That's just one.
Well,
decision.
I'll give you another one. The NDIS, Barnaby Joyce, is another one. When it gets up and rolling, could be incredibly expensive, more so than people expect. Is the government completely committed to it, though? Because certainly in opposition, it was a unity ticket on the NDIS.
Yes, it is, but you're dead right. You have to look closely at the actuarial tables on these things. You can't just sit in isolation. You must make sure that to be kind to the people you want to help, the people who deserve that help, you have to be stringent and diligent with how expansive the program is, because otherwise it just becomes unfundable. And if it's underfundable, it's inoperable, and therefore it won't be able to be rolled out because you just won't have the money for it. You can't just make the solution to every problem that we're going to borrow more money, remembering that these are straight-out expense items. They're not a capital item. You have an argument at times for the expenditure on capital items that increase the size of your base, that you have an asset on the book that at some stage in the future you can redeem by selling. But if it's a straight-out expense item on your P&L, no, it's just locked in there. And if you ever go to try and remove it, then there's political ramifications because of all the structure that's set up around it. So, yes, you have to keep a very close eye on your actuarial tables on where that expense is going forward. Make sure it's clearly targeted to the people that you really want to help. Make sure it doesn't grow. And I truly believe that on our side of government, we have the competence to do that. Because you have people who in their life have actually run a business, and by gosh, that's a very good start to running another one.
Minister, you've taken a high profile in relation to small business. Can I ask you about the effects test? This is a contentious issue for the Turnbull government. What is your expectation as Deputy Prime Minister about the way the government will address this issue of the effects test?
Well, it's obviously sitting with Kelly O'Dwyer and Scott Morrison at the moment. We believe that our core constituency, I think in both the National Party and the Liberal Party, is small business. We have to make sure that that core constituency, because they are the overwhelming driver of the economy, the overwhelming driver of employment, and more than that, the philosophy that is espoused in small business, that is to be master of your own ship, to get to your highest level of freedom, basically by the sweat of your own brow, that is seen by running your own business. And so we want to always make sure that that constituency clearly sees us as fighting on their behalf. Now, the Harper Review brought forward a whole range of issues, but the biggest one is to make sure that those people, when they start from the bottom, can be treated fairly, because it's manifest in what we are as a political movement, in both the National Party and the Liberal Party, that a person from nowhere can start at the bottom and with the right skills and the right effort, and a bit of luck, that they can go through that social stratification and make their way to the top. That's the nation that we want to live in. That's the sort of philosophy that drove me into politics, and we have to stand behind that in how these people are treated in the marketplace. So that will be the focus, I believe, of the National Party, will be the focus of the coalition. But let's wait to see where Kelly and Scott land on this issue, and obviously we'll be part of the discussions as it gets to that point of finalisation.
But do you think you can deliver? Do you think you can deliver for the small business constituency? It's one thing for them to see you fighting for them. What counts is the outcome. Can you get the outcome for them?
Well, as you know, Paul, the last substantive change to what was then known as the Trade Practices Act, and now the Competition Consumer Act, was Section 46(1)(AA), the so-called Birdsville Amendment, which was written by the National Party. In fact, it was with assistance written by myself. This is to deal with issues surrounding predatory pricing and to deal with issues and what we believe was the inadequacies of a person to prosecute a case. You know, it's called the Birdsville Amendment because the last iteration of it was faxed from the Birdsville Hotel. It was a writing in as we drove around out west. So I think we have got the record that we can actually deliver, that we can actually... I'm sorry about these flies here, Paul. You guys are doing it all right in the studio, but I...
Well, we did extend the invitation to join us in here, Barnaby Joyce.
Mate, I don't know whether it's in that error guard. I think that error guard is called cow manure.
I just want to clarify this, though, because this is an important point. I think you're saying to us you do believe you can prevail on this issue.
Yeah, I do. We don't go through the Harper Review and then get to the end of it and say, well, we're not accepting any of that. That's what the Labor Party did with the Henry Tax Review, and we go through things. Our goal remains the same, that we will try... and we will deliver some form of betterment so that people who are in business, small business, can be treated in a fairer way as they have the capacity to get themselves before a court if they've been pushed around by people who are not beating them by reason of competition, who are beating them just because they're bigger and knocking them out just to get rid of them. That's not good for our economy. It's certainly not good for the aspiration of a person to want to go into business. And we know that we want to drive, we believe, that's why we came up with ABNs and tradies became their own business people. We believe that people and businesses are a good thing. And we want to make sure that as an economy, we have that dynamism, which comes from a whole range of people going into business and fighting as they to try and get to the top, because that gives us the smarts to have a progressive and growing economy, another way to sort of grow the pie, so to speak, and keep ourselves in a strong economic position. So on a whole range of levels, on the philosophical level of what we believe in as the right of an individual, on the economic reason, on the dynamism of an economy, we must have small business. And I think that at the end of this process, there will be a greater game plan that these people are treated fairly.
I think you might have given us a good news hook there, Barnaby Joyce. We're talking to the Deputy Prime Minister. We'll continue doing so when we come back about a range of issues, including the new look Nationals lineup on the front bench. Back in